So let's get started with our discussion of optimization over convex sets. So I want to solve the problem, minimize the function fx such that x is in some convex set, capital X. Like most other problems which we are going to consider in this class, the function f is differentiable as many times as you would like, and the set X is a convex set, X in Rn, non-empty, closed, convex. Okay. So now, what we did was necessary condition for optimality. We ended the previous lecture with necessary condition for optimality. I want to go over the proof for that, but before that, let me give you an example or two examples where such kind of optimization problems appear. Okay, so the first example is multi-commodity network problem. So let's look at what the problem is. I have a source, call it node A, and then I have B, C, D, and then I have a destination E, and there are links. There is an input of RW. So this is the input traffic. Input traffic, and then there is the output traffic. And of course, we want the input traffic to be equal to the output traffic. So it should be equal to RW. Okay. The goal here is there is some amount of cost associated with sending certain amount of traffic through each of the links. So we want to minimize the total cost of sending the input traffic to the destination. So this is the source node and this is the destination node. And if you want to send x1 amount here and x2 amount here, then there is certain cost associated with it. And so you want to minimize the total cost, but you also need to maintain the constraint. So B, for instance, cannot directly send a packet to D, okay? So B can only send a packet to C, or B can send a packet to E, node E, which is the destination node. So you have to maintain all the network constraints, which is essentially depicted using these edges between nodes. And there is, of course, an arrow because the packet can only flow in the direction of the arrow, okay? So it's not an undirected graph, it's a directed graph. So we want to pose this problem as an optimization problem, and then we will, I mean, of course, we will just get the formulation, and then after that, we will just develop tools in the rest of the subsequent lectures about how to solve problems of this type. So let's proceed with the formulation. So let me assume that there is x1 amount of traffic going through this path. So what is the path? AB and BE. So that's the path. And there is X1 amount of traffic going through this path. There is X2 amount of traffic going through AB, BC, and CE. Similarly, there is X3 amount of traffic going through AD, DC, and CE. And then there is X4 amount of traffic going through ADE. So let me make this notion of paths more formal. So I define a set P, which is a set of all paths from sources A to destination E. And this is given by AB, BD, BE, AB, BC, and CE, and then AD, DE, AD, DC, CE. Yes.
So this problem models a centralized distribution of
yes.
the flow.
Yes.
So it would be like UPS deciding how they were going to get things from LA to
yes.
New York and not traffic flow for an individual getting from
no.
LA to
no. New York. Traffic flow by individual agents is a much more harder problem to solve, so that's not part of this class.
So, are we assuming any capacities or just cost?
So far, no capacity constraints, but certainly capacity constraints are there in real channels. So, the capacity constraints are important only when the capacity constraints may be active due to the nature of flow. So, if I give you an example of electricity grid, each of the transmission lines that you see when you are on a highway has certain constraints, but most of the winter and on a normal day like this, none of those constraints are active, and so it's equivalent to having no capacity constraints. Okay, any further question? Yes.
Couldn't you always model capacity constraints as another cost and have it be essentially the cost in different units to add the capacity to transport?
We will talk about it in 20 lectures from now. You're talking about Lagrange relaxation, which is not the topic we will study until, I don't know, 2 weeks later. Okay. So what's the constraint? So let me first identify what the constraints are. So the first constraint that we all agree upon is, well, xi has to be greater than or equal to 0, right? The second constraint we want is summation of xi should be equal to rw, I equals 1 to 4. And then that's the only constraint that we have. We don't have any capacity constraints. If there were capacity constraints, then we'll have to, let's get to the capacity constraint in a little bit more time. Okay, but these are the constraints on the variables x1, x2, x3, and x4. Now, if Rw is given and constant, then it's very easy to show that the set of x that satisfy these constraints actually forms a convex set, okay? It probably looks something like this, okay? This would be the set. Of course, this is in four dimension, and this is, I can only show two-dimensional figure on the board, so it's not a true, the true picture, but it should look something like a parallelepiped or a convex polygon, okay, in R4. That's what it's going to look like. Now, the other thing I want to define is variables F, I, J, which is the flow through node I to node J. Okay? So F, A, B is actually equal to X1 plus X2. And F, C, E will be equal to X2 plus X3 and so on. Yes.
So when we're talking about those constraints making the problem convex, what would need to change in the network to make this sort of problem not convex?
That's a good question.
Or is it just
I think this nature, by the nature of the problem, it has to be convex.
Okay.
Things are additive in this case. Any other question? Okay, so now I have defined, so there are variables x1, x2, x3, x4, those are the basic variables here. But then I define new variables f, I, j, which is the flow from node I to node j. And the cost actually depends on f, I, j. So the cost along this link is actually c, b, e, and then F, B, E. So the flow through node B to node E and the cost of any flow through from node B to node E. Okay, so this is a function, C, B, E is a function of a scalar variable. And that's the cost that is incurred by sending this much amount of flow through this particular link. And now the goal is I want to minimize the summation of Cij, Fij, and the summation is over all ij pairs that are there in the network, subject to this constraint and these constraints. Okay, and that's a convex minimization problem over a convex set, because the set of all x and all f satisfying these constraints are it forms a convex set. F is in R7. The dimension of f is in R7, and x is in R4. So this is an 11-dimensional problem. Okay. Now, is there a way to reduce the dimensionality of this problem? So I formulated this problem over R11. Is there a way I could reduce the dimension of the problem itself? Okay, this is something you have done in assignment 1, right? You had a two-dimensional problem, that was the assignment 1 problem 4 on the electricity market. You had a two-dimensional problem, right? C1 x1 plus C2 x2. And then you reduce the dimension of the problem by eliminating the equality constraint, right? So whenever you have an optimization problem with equality constraint, and you have many of them here, right, you can reduce the dimension of the problem substantially. And so this problem can actually be formulated over R3. Okay, because you can eliminate all these flow constraints that are equality constraints. You can plug this in, x2 plus x3 right here. You can plug in x1 plus x2 right here. And you can get you can eliminate all the f variables. And then you are left with this equality constraint. And then you can substitute x4 equals rw minus x1 minus x2 minus x3. And then all you have to do is minimize with respect to x1, x2, and x3. Okay. Subject to 4 inequality constraints. So this is a technique that is sometimes useful to minimize or to reduce the complexity of the optimization problem, especially when you have equality constraints. You can actually get rid of a lot of variables and simplify your problem substantially. And you did this in your assignment 1, and this is something that we will again encounter in some time during subsequent lectures. So this problem is widely studied in operations research. I don't quite know what the history of this problem is because I don't work in this field, but my feeling is a class of this problem was defined for communication networks, which is how do you route the packets when you are, you know, all of you use internet. So how do you route the packets from the server from where you are requesting the data to your actual machine where you are actually receiving the data?
You talked about how a lot of the initial optimization work was done with a military concern.
Yes.
That could easily be a how you ship supplies at a specific point. And so it wouldn't need to be a modern data application. You could have had that
yes.
in the 40s.
Yes, it could be during 40s when people wanted to move military from one point to another. So what's the fastest way to move people and so on. But I don't quite know what the history of this problem is. But it's a multi-commodity flow problem, so network problem. So you should have a network, and you should have a commodity which could be routed by various routes within the network. So it has pretty wide applicability. Okay, so is it clear why this optimization problem fits within this framework? Okay, you can easily pose this problem as a minimization problem over a convex set. And the constraints are all physical constraints. It comes from the physics. Some quantities have to be preserved as it flows through the network.
So in this case, there are sets, capital sets.
Yes.
Would that just be the valid or the principal values of the little x's then? So that's the principal value of amount of commodity flowing.
Yes. So it will be, so that capital X will be the set of all X that satisfies these constraints and these constraints.
Okay.
Yeah. Yes.
If the costs are just scalars, they wouldn't add extra.
So for instance, my cost Cij of F could be AF plus B. So, what do you mean by extra variables? Okay.
So, this problem doesn't fit something where it's a resource that's consumed as you move throughout.
Yes. Yes. So there is no loss of resource while it is moving through the network. Now, you know, I'm not a civil engineer, but one could assume that if there are set of canals taking water from a big reservoir to some area, some agricultural or city kind of area, then there could be some amount of water loss that could either seep through the canal to the ground, or it could actually get evaporated and get into the atmosphere. So there could be some amount of leakage in those kind of networks. But I don't quite know whether canal networks are modeled as multi-commodity network problem or not.
It could also be transported something like gasoline, where the cost is quantity you're trying to build.
Right. Okay. Now I want to get the second example from electricity market, because that's an area where I work. So I want to come up with a very simple example. So this is electricity market. So you have a two-node network. There is a generator at node 1. There is a generator at node 2. And then there is a city, which is, think of it as a load, at the second node. So this is node 1, and this is node 2. And this line, this transmission line, has a capacity, let's say capital C. That's the capacity. That's the maximum megawatt of electricity that can be moved from node 1 to node 2. Typically, capacities would be in the form of amperes. How many amperes can flow through these wires from node 1 to node 2? And so the minimization problem would be, I want to minimize C1, which is the cost of generating Q1 units of electricity at generator 1, plus C2, Q2. So Q2 is the amount of electricity that generator 2 will generate, such that Q1 plus Q2 equals to the demand D, and Q1 is less than equal to capital C, greater than equal to 0. And Q2 is greater than equal to 0. Again, this is a minimization problem over a convex set. Okay, the demand is given, the capacity is given, and so it becomes a optimization over a convex set problem. Q1 is the gen. How much? Oh, C1 is the cost of generating Q1 units of electricity. So, you know, why do you think there should be a generator within the city? Can someone tell me why would there be a generator in the city? Yeah.
I mean, it's a type of power that you could actually have in the city. So, if you had something like solar, or you could have that physically located in a park somewhere, but generator 1 could be a huge nuclear power plant that
people right.
in their backyard.
Right. So generator 1 could be a nuclear power station, or could be a very big gas or coal-fired power plant station far off from the city. And then generator 2 is actually, it might be a gas or it might be a coal-fired power plant. But the reason why sometimes large cities will have generators in them is for reliability purpose, because there are hospitals and other areas that are sensitive. They need power 24 hours. And so these generators act as backups, just in case if generator 1 fails or this line fails, then there is a way to power all the hospitals and other emergency services within the area. So there is a category 4 hurricane coming in North Carolina and South Carolina, and all these generators will be trying to be up and running so that they could provide auxiliary power just in case of power loss.
And there will be plenty.
And will be? Oh, yeah. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
So this sort of problem only works when we have one city or load conceptualization. How likely is an electricity market problem to be separable, or where we could have that gigantic generator 1 supplying multiple different cities and loads with different capacities, is, and it not involving nonlinear factors?
So typically, you know, of course, for simplicity, I have two generators here, but typically these networks are of the order of 1,000 generators over a very wide geographical area, like Midwest of United States, right? Very large. And there'll be lots of capacity constraints and line constraints and lots of non-linearities, and people have to take care of that. And it takes about 3 hours or 4 hours to solve the problem for the next day. So the generation for the next day that they will be planning today, right? For this entire United States, around 2 p.m. or 3 p.m., they would start running the code for the next day, for figuring out how much each generator should generate the next day by solving a much more sophisticated version of this problem on some supercomputers, okay? That's pretty normal across most of the countries around the world. Now, the problem nowadays that people are facing is that there is a lot of renewables that adds a lot of uncertainty here. And so one has to be prepared for any contingency that could appear because it was a cloudy day or because the wind didn't blow as we expected it to blow and so on. So things are becoming extremely difficult to manage in some of these markets where the amount of renewable generation is pretty high. So places like Hawaii is facing a lot of problems because of that, because there's a lot of renewables, very little conventional generators. And then California, that's facing another problem because lots of people are very rich and they have solar power on their rooftop, and aggregate solar power generated within California is too big. So in the afternoon, which is 2 p.m. to 7 p.m., there is the solar power is going down, so you have to start ramping up all the generators to provide electricity for everyone. And what happens is people go back home from their offices, and then they plug in their electric cars, and then they start cooking or whatever, right? So the demand goes up at 7 p.m. It's a peak, right? One of the peak demands at 7 p.m. So that's what California is seeing nowadays, right? So they have to go from 2 p.m. to 7 p.m., you have to go from half of generation to full-blown 26,000 megawatt generation. So it's a big problem there. Anyways, so that should... So that is just to convince you that this problem has a lot of application. And there are many situations where these constraints would naturally arise because of some physical constraints that's there in the physical system itself. Now, going back to the necessary conditions, so we studied necessary conditions for optimality in the case of unconstrained optimization. Because we learned that gradient descent actually converges to a stationary point which only satisfies the first order necessary condition. So it will turn out that that is the case even for problems of this type. And so we need to understand what exactly does it mean for a necessary condition to be satisfied in this kind of optimization problem. So that's why we need to understand how does the necessary conditions, how can we prove the necessary conditions for optimality? So the necessary conditions were if X star is optimal, then gradient of F at X star transpose X minus X star is greater than or equal to 0 for all X in capital X. Let us prove this, and the proof is by contradiction, which I don't particularly like proofs by contradiction, but I couldn't think of a proof without contradiction in this situation. So suppose there exists an X. There exists X bar such that gradient of F X star transpose X bar minus X star is strictly less than 0. Okay, so I'm assuming X star is optimal. That's part of the hypothesis for the theorem. And then I'm assuming that there exists an X bar where this inequality is violated. Then mean value theorem says implies that f of x star plus epsilon x bar minus x star is given by f of x star plus epsilon Okay. Now, what happens when epsilon is sufficiently small? Okay. I know that this is true. Okay. I know that this is strictly negative. And delta epsilon, so if epsilon is small, then delta epsilon is also very small. Gradient of f is all continuous, nice, smooth function. So, what it means is this term is going to be negative for epsilon sufficiently small. Okay. So if epsilon is small, that term is going to be strictly less than zero, which means that this term is going to be less than f of x star. Okay, so this term is strictly negative. I'm going to move from x star in a very, I take a very small step in some direction, x bar minus x star, and then I know that this derivative is not going to change much, and so the derivative transpose x bar minus x star will still remain negative as long as epsilon is sufficiently small. And so what I have is, if I take a step in this direction, a small step in this direction, x bar minus x star, then I can get a cost which is strictly less than f of x star. This is a contradiction because x star was a local minimum. Okay, so this must necessarily hold true. This is merely an application of the mean value theorem.
Wouldn't we then have to have already stated that x bar was in the disk of points that we consider there to be local, which we haven't yet?
X bar will be in x. So, you have this set X. You claim that this is my X star, and I have this X bar. So, if I go in this direction, the gradient of F at X star, inner product with X bar minus X star is less than zero.
Yeah, I agree if it's because X star is a global min, which isn't that what it's supposed to be when it's on a convex set. But if it's a local min, we have to do something more to bound x bar, that it has to be within the region we're considering local. And we didn't make that statement yet, unless the statement about it being part of the convex set is sufficient, which means it's a global minimum.
No. I'm assuming, so for this particular result, I'm assuming that f could be non-convex. Okay, so no matter which direction you want to go to, as long as, and you want to go in a direction so that you remain within the convex set, so you have to consider all possible, so no matter which, so for every possible x bar, this epsilon is something that you choose, right? So let's say your x bar was here, you picked a value of epsilon equals 1 over 100, and so you are essentially looking only in this neighborhood, right? Or you could pick a value of epsilon even lower, and then you are looking at neighborhood very close to the point x star.
Okay, so x bar doesn't do anything other than give us a direction we want
yes.
to get
yes.
a more
yes.
point.
Okay. Yes. So x bar is just giving you a direction so that you don't go out of the set. Any other question? Okay. So in order to understand the, if we want to understand some of the algorithms which are required for solving problems of this type, we need to understand a very specific concept called projection of a point onto a set. Okay? So let me give you an example why this would be important. So I have a set, an arbitrary convex set. I am at a boundary, let's say xk, and I'm told to go in this direction, dk. But what happens is, any value for any value of alpha k greater than 0, this would be your xk plus alpha k dk. You are outside the set, right? Now, from this point, you want to get back into the set because you don't want to go outside the set while you are doing the optimization. So what you have to do is do a projection so that you can come back into the set. So what's the desirable property of this particular operation projection? So you want to get to the point that is closest within the set. Okay, so from this point, I want to find a point in the set which is closest to this particular point. So that comes under projection theorem. So need to find projection. So what we will do is we will try to pose this as an optimization problem, and then we will study some of the properties of projection. Anybody knows what the time is? Oh, we have a lot of time. Okay. So I have a point z in Rn, and I want to solve the following problem. X star equals argmin of z minus x square. I am taking the two norm here, subject to the constraint that x lies in capital X. So x star is this particular point. Let me draw another diagram. This is my point z, and I want to find this point x star, which is closest in the set capital X. So what are the properties of this point x star? X is in Rn, closed convex set, non-empty as well. So the first result is, for every z in Rn, there exists a unique x star in capital X such that x star solves, let me call this star. Okay, so let's take another example. I have a circle. I have a point Z here. What's the closest point in this circle, in this sphere? It's the point right here. That's your X star. That's the point at the boundary. And this is the center. And you can draw a straight line from center to Z, which passes through X star. So for every such z, there exists a unique x star that satisfies the this particular problem. The second property is z minus x star transpose x minus x star is less than equal to 0 for every x in Rn. Let's see what this means. So, z minus x star is this particular vector, and I pick any arbitrary point in x. So, this is my x minus x star, this is my z minus x star, and what do we observe? It makes an angle that is greater than 90 degrees. Okay, and therefore their inner product has to be less than equal to 0. Yes?
Isn't that x element of the convex set, not the RDN there? Because otherwise.
Oh, yes. Yes.
Otherwise, I can just pick the z.
Yes, that's right. That's right. The third point is that it's a non-expansive operator. So let me define x star equals pi of z. Okay. This is also in the book. This is the notation given in the book, okay? Mm-hmm. But sometimes if you're reading paper, they use pi to denote projection of a point onto the set capital X. So we will stick to the notation in the book. We won't be using this notation, but I wanted to show you that this notation is widely used in some of the research papers on optimization. So this operator is actually non-expansive. That means z1 plus minus z2 plus, if I take the norm, it's less than equal to z1 minus z2. Okay, let's look at it, what's happening in the picture. So I have my z1, I have my z2, this is the center. So my x1 will be somewhere here, and x2 star would be here. And the distance between these two points is less than the distance between these two points. Okay, so this is my x1 star minus x2 star. Okay, so the distance between projections is lower than the distance between the original points you started with. And then the fourth point is that if X is a subspace then Z minus X star transpose X is equal to 0 for all X in capital X. And I want to give you the picture. So I have a three-dimensional space. What would a subspace look like? Yes, it's a plane going through the origin. So a subspace would look something like this, where origin is in the plane itself. And I pick a point Z outside the set. What this result is saying that if you look at the X star, which lies in the plane, it will make a 90 degree angle with the plane itself. Okay, so there is this plane, there is Z, and if you look at Z minus X star, that's going to be perpendicular to the plane itself. And so no matter which vector you take, so this would be X1 or X2 or X3, all these vectors are in the plane, and therefore it will make a right angle with Z minus X star, which is this particular vector. And so their inner product will actually be equal to 0. Okay. So one thing you will notice about projection theorem is that the optimization problem itself is actually a convex optimization problem. So in some cases, for instance, in the case of a sphere or in the case of a box, or in the case of a hyperplane, the projection is an extremely easy operation. You can actually get the expression in closed form. Okay. So then you don't have to go through, you don't really have to solve the optimization problem because projection is easy. Now in some cases you could have a weird set, for instance an ellipsoid, in which case the projection would become a very difficult operation. But still it's a convex optimization problem. So the way one would work in those situations is within each iteration of the gradient descent, if you have to do the projection because your point lies outside the set, then you will have to solve this minimization problem. So within this outer gradient descent, there is an inner gradient descent that's trying to solve this projection problem. Okay? But then you would say that, okay, my computational cost has gone up for this particular problem, so we probably need to modify our problem itself, or we need to modify the model itself so that your computational cost is under control. So typically you use projection when your set is well behaved, So your x could be a less than equal to x less than equal to b. Your x could be norm of x less than equal to r. Your set x could be this is sphere, this is box, this is known as box, this is sphere, your x greater than equal to 0, this is cone, positive cone, what else? In what other cases is projection pretty easy? Oh, ax equal to b. Just a minute. X equals to ax equal to b. Yeah.
The on the cone, how is x being greater than 0 if a positive cone? It's just
positive quadrant. In two dimensional, it's a positive quadrant. In one dimension, it's just a positive real line. So that's called a cone, because if you take a vector and you scale the vector lies within the set itself. Yeah. Okay. So in all these situations, you can find the projection pretty easily, and we will cover. Do we have time today? So let me show you. We do have 3 minutes. So in for this particular case, box case, your projection Z is ZI if, so Z plus and I. So I want to look at the ith component. If AI less than equal to ZI less than equal to BI, it's AI if ZI is less than AI, and it's BI if ZI is greater than BI. Okay, so I'm looking at the ith component of the projection, and all I have to do is just, if it is within the interval, you're good. If it is outside the interval, just get it to the end points. So I want to show you the picture, what it looks like. So I have the box constraint in R2. If this is my x, then my projection, sorry, this is my point Z, then this is my x1 star, this is my point Z2, then this is my x2 star. Okay, so projection is very easy in the box. Sphere, you just have to rescale it. Positive cone, similar to box. So clip all the negative values to 0. And then you have AX equal to B, for which we will study the projection in the next class. Any questions so far? Okay? All right, thank you guys. I'll see you on Friday.